Hello, everybody. Welcome to part two of our interview with Justin Marr, The Way of Archery, with my fellow host here, Jacek.
Hello, everyone.
Okay. Thank you very much for part one, Justin. We had a lot of really interesting feedback with it. Now, you're going to run through some basic shot process of the going style for us, yes?
That's right, yes. And what I'll provide is a very basic introduction that I teach to my private lesson students one-on-one. These are people who usually don't have archery experience. So you'll have to pardon some of the very simplified explanations of bow, shoulder position, and draw, because you know you don't want to give them a fire hose of knowledge all at once. That's very off-putting. So I'm going to start very simply with an explanation that can be applied easily. So when we're talking about shooting a bow and an arrow, we can start with our feet position. What I teach...
Justin, before we get into it too much, I'm just going to pin you up as the main screen so everybody can see nice and clearly. There you go. So we're looking at you, okay? And we'll just let you run through, yeah?
Sure, sounds good. So we'll start with feet position. And let's say that target is in this direction. So there are obviously a few different choices. You can either have parallel feet running in a line toward the target. You can have a more frontal stance. Some people call this an open stance. Or you could have a closed stance where the torso is facing away from the target. So what I teach my students is to have a little more of a frontal stance. It's kind of a nice balanced position. Of course, when you get more experience, you can try other foot configurations. And obviously, if you're on the field, you know, in a sort of an unconventional shooting scenario, then you're going to have to shoot in any kind of stance, you know, any kind of crazy stance that you encounter. But for now, about 45 degrees, facing a little more frontal to the target. The next part would be the waist and the hips. So I don't advocate for having a position that's too far like this, you know, when you arch your lower back and you're sticking your butt out. You will only see that type of position for people who are shooting insanely heavy bows, 140 pounds, 170 pounds, 200 pounds. For most of us, you don't need to have that sort of flexion, that sort of bend in the lower back. So it's good to kind of keep that lower back straight just to keep it nice and relaxed and also have relatively good balance as well. You want to make sure that your center of gravity is between your 2 feet. Then we get to how to hold the bow itself. Now, if you look at your bow hand, in the web of your hand, you'll notice there's a little crease here. I like to tell folks to put the bow, the center of the bow, in the center of that crease, like so. Because if you have the bow hand too much like this, or too much like this, you know, you're not gonna have a good hold. Like this is Justin, just not stable. This will make
Justin,
the string prone to slap your wrist.
Stop for a moment. There's a big thing saying Justin's network is too slow.
Yes, oh, no. And it only just starts happening when you stretch your hand out.
So you froze.
Yes.
So your broadband, okay. Mr. Google, there, Mr.
Well, you know, I live in a area which only has, well, DSL available to me. So it's kind of like, yeah.
Okay. So we're not going to worry about it too much. But if you could repeat the last bit.
Just from your hand.
Talk about the hand position.
Which, okay, so I was like, so was I somewhere here?
Yes, yeah, perfect, absolutely. Yes.
Okay. Great. Okay, here we go. So we'll talk about the bow hand here. You'll notice in your bow hand, the web of the hand, there's a crease. I like to put the center of the bow handle in the center of that crease, like so. And you'll notice that the thumb is going to be sort of naturally pointed at a slightly offset angle, maybe about 12:30 o'clock, almost 1 o'clock. You don't want your bow hand wrist to be too much like this. It's unstable. You don't want it to be too much like this because the string is going to be liable to slap you. Okay, and you don't want it to be too high up or too high down. I mean, there's room to experiment with this later, but for now, just keep a nice neutral bow hand wrist. Have the center of the bow handle in the center of the crease in the web of your hand. This is your arrow shelf right here. That arrow is going to be resting on top like so. Okay.
So will it also touch then the index finger about, or just the thumb? Will it just only touch the finger, is the index, or just the thumb?
I would say just the thumb for now. Obviously, you're welcome to try experiment. I know friends who will rest it on their index finger, or they'll have like a wedge between their index finger and their thumb to use there. I just teach simply let it rest on your thumb. And then you, obviously you can experiment with that later. Right. This is something that's very personal, the bow hand, but I think that this position works for most people.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next thing is the draw hand with the ring. The ring that I'm using here is one with a little bit of a string guard. You will see that there's a little bit of a saddle point here, and that's where the string is going to be lying across that, so it doesn't make heavy contact with the skin. There are other styles of ring where you rest the string at the edge of the lip here. And the technique that I'm, you know, the general draw technique that I teach, it should not change too much depending, you know, regardless of the style of ring that you're using. So here we go. And of course, if, for folks who are shooting bare thumb, I would say you could rest the string at the crease right here. But for most people, especially if you're going to shoot bows of particular draw weight and you want to avoid having a numb thumb, then using a ring is preferred here. So the key here, there's a bit of a Goldilocks principle with the draw hand thumb. You don't want it to be too shallow. You don't want it, if you don't bend it around the string enough, then you won't have enough purchase on the string. It'll slip out before you're ready to release. If you turn it too far around like this, then for most rings, that's going to cause the ring to sort of dig into the skin of your thumb. It's not going to be very comfortable, and you're not going to have a comfortable release either. So what I tell folks is you want to have that ring contact surface to be about perpendicular to the to where the arrow is. So it's going to look a bit like this. And then simply cover the thumbnail with your index finger. There's some variation in terms of how deeply you want to hook. Too shallow is going to be a little hard to hold, too deep, and it's going to be kind of dirty on the release. Some sort of intermediate hold should be good here. And I'll do this with an arrow. So what's important here is that you want that ring to make contact with the arrow nock here. If you're inconsistent with where you're placing that ring, like you just put here, 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 that creates a lot of variability that you don't want. So just to have a steady reference, put that ring, let it touch the nock. And then you can cover the index finger with the thumb. Now it's important here to let the index finger slightly touch the side of the arrow. This is why the thumb draw is good for mobile situations, because this actually prevents the arrow from falling off. See that? And one exercise that I tell students to do is, you know, once you have this position, once you've established the thumb lock, try to rotate the bow horizontal this way, horizontal that way. And in fact, in the full technique, you're actually letting the bow tilt just a little bit like this as you're drawing. But that index finger on the draw hand side prevents that arrow from falling. So that's key here. Of course, you don't want it to be excessive pressure either. Because if you press too hard, then it's going to kind of bend the arrow as you're drawing it and alter the flight characteristics. A light touch is good enough here. Sorry, go ahead.
So the ring itself touches the middle finger, or the actual finger, the thumb itself, or does it have to be the ring touching the middle finger? I had people asking this question.
You know, I know that certain techniques advocate the ring touching the middle finger. I'm agnostic to that. And in fact, you know, I find that some of my strongest thumb draw positions is allowing the thumb ring to not touch the middle finger. This is just practical experience. I know it goes against doctrine for certain Middle Eastern styles, but just based on practical experience, you know, just, you know, if that separates and floats during the draw, that's okay. And in fact, the Chinese texts don't go into too much detail about that. They just say, you know, you hook it with one finger or you hook it with two fingers, and they kind of leave it at that.
Yeah, and when you mentioned that the ring touches always the arrow on the string, the ring the knock, will that only work with the knocking point? So let's say we don't have the knocking point, then the arrow could be pushed up, right?
It could. You know, I think I advocate shooting with a knock indicator. Provides consistency. I don't know accurate shooters who shoot without a knock indicator. So it's good to have one. It could work without a knock indicator if the string is thick enough and the knock holds onto the string like rather tightly, but it's not going to be it's not something that I would teach.
Right.
Yeah. Something I should mention too. So I mentioned, you know, to test your draw hand, you want to kind of see if you can rotate the bow like this. Now with the bow hand, to ensure that you want to ensure that the arrow is resting on your thumb is that de facto arrow shelf. So I'll tell students to kind of lift the bow up and down like this. Make sure it's steady there. Because if it's slipping off, then obviously they don't quite have the angles right. And one more detail that I should mention here with the bow hand thumb, you want it to rest just below the arrow pass area of the handle. Because if you hold it too high, then you know, that arrow, that fletching is liable to scratch your hand on the way out. And if you hold it too low, then that arrow is probably going to porpoise as well. The key to this is that you should have your knock indicator on your bow set as low as possible, but without having the feather scratch your hand. You notice I don't wear any bow hand gloves or anything like that. Don't need it. Because I know that if I set the knock indicator at the correct height and I place my hand in a consistent position, then I'm not going to scratch myself.
So it's a good indicator if we get scratching a hand, something we're doing wrong with our bow hand.
Yeah, like if it's scratching the hand, typically beginners will tense up their thumb and let it creep up like this, and then they scratch themselves, or they're not aware of where they're holding it, and so they might hold it too high on occasion. So just developing a good kind of, you know, developing some muscle memory on where to grip it is a good habit to develop.
Yeah, customizing your own bow, it can help with having some indicator point on your bow hand. So you always
I mean, as an archer, it's not just about, you know, what you do in motion; it's about the preparation that you do with your equipment. Right, you are just as responsible for that as you are for the shooting technique. Right, some people are like, oh, well, my equipment, it was this, or that something, well, you know, that happened and that's why I missed the shot. And it's like, well, it's your responsibility to fix your equipment before that. So, you know, you can't blame the equipment. Ultimately the blame falls on you, right? So, so I've talked about the bow hand. I've talked about the draw hand. Now we get to a very quick explanation of the draw itself. So very simply, I tell students, point the arrow of the bow in the direction of the target. And let's start with the bow hand at about eye nose level. This does a couple of things, right? It encourages students to have a proper bow shoulder position. Of course, you know, beginning students will have trouble with hunching shoulders and things like that, but I tell them at least to start off with this position, keep the shoulders down. And when you're going to draw, try to lead the draw with the elbow, like that. Because what you'll see sometimes with beginners is they'll try to lead with the wrist, and then they'll end up chicken winging it, right? They'll draw it kind of like this, and they'll wonder why it's so hard, right? Because they're not taking advantage of their back muscles yet. So I tell them, lead with the elbow, like so. And so I will have them go through some minor dry pulls just to get used to the technique. Or sometimes I'll have them do partial draws and releases. You know, what works for you, maybe you can try it out. And then full draw in this case will be when you draw far enough that the draw elbow is closed and the arrow is about mouth level, like so.
Sorry, one quick interruption. When you say closed, you mean that there's no space between your bicep and your forearm? Is that what you mean?
That's correct, yeah. That's what I mean by closed. Okay. Yep. So all the way closed here. So it looks like this. That's full draw position. Obviously different styles prefer a shorter draw length or longer draw length. That's up for you to experiment with later on, but this is a medium draw length that it's a good middle ground that I practice for myself that I like to start my students off with as well. And then once you get to full draw, then you continue drawing back and back and back and back. And then you'll let the thumb and the index finger involuntarily let go as you continue to pull back. You know, there are some styles that advocate active opening of the fingers or a twist of the wrist here or there. It's going to really depend on the type of thumb ring that you're using or the type of style that you're practicing. But I just advocate simply let those thumb and index finger open, relax involuntarily as you keep pulling back. And then the full technique will look like so. So the hands at eye nose level, I'm going to lead the draw with my elbow as I pull back. I'm going to draw until I get to full draw where the draw elbow is closed. Then I'll keep pulling back through the release. And that's all there is to the basic shot sequence. I wouldn't expect a beginner to understand this follow through. I will tell them that this is not a forced thing. Like, we don't try to force this to happen. This is a reaction. So, but I focus on just the basics of the stance, the bow hand and the draw hand techniques, and then the basic draw starting from here to here, and then through release.
Would you recommend engaging the core muscles at all, or?
You mean this? These muscles. I don't make a huge. I just want to be in a kind of a nice balanced position. You could, but I don't make a huge deal out of it here.
I think if you're in an open stance and slightly twisted, it naturally engages anyway.
I think that would probably be a different kind of extended discussion right there. I have some thoughts about that, but I don't want to confuse people.
Can I just ask about the release then? When you release that time, your hand finished quite a long way back. Sometimes when we see you release, it's not much further than your ear. Presumably, it's just a completely relaxed thing. You're not trying to aim to get in exactly the same place every time, or?
Right, yeah, it's just a reaction to the sort of the linear expansion that happens before the release. Mm-hmm. And it's just momentum after the shot. Now, the difference between a follow-through that ends here and then it ends here is just that with this, I'm letting the elbow open up, because I want the hand to travel in a straight line after the shot. The other is where I just keep the elbow closed throughout the whole sequence. So if I keep the elbow closed, there's sort of a natural stopping point here. But that's custom. You know, the follow through is custom, and it happens after the shot. So
because you do see a lot of people, and you know they're forcing that throw away behind them, you know. So
and that
bow arm drops as they do it.
that force release is a problem for sure. And I talk about some of this in a video called The Release. That kind of goes into an extended discussion about the release there. But yeah, you know, you want you basically just want to have a steady bow arm through the release sequence. If you're just like, you know, using your back without regards to the stability of, you know, your bow arm and draw arm during the release sequence, then you might have something like, I'm using my back, and you release like this, and that's going to just throw everything off, right? I just advocate keep that bow arm in a steady position. And you're good to go. I mean, obviously, when I mentioned the bow hand grip, it's a half relaxed grip. You're holding with this, these fingers are relaxed. And so there's a little bit of give, you know, that there's a little bit of give in the bow during the shot. You want to avoid having a grip where it's an iron, you know, all five fingers very tight, because that's going to interfere with the cushioning effect that the bow hand should provide.
I think to me, what stands out watching you just run through that sequence is every part of it looks relaxed and not forced. That's the from the grip on the bow to the pullback to the release. You know, it's you don't look like you're holding the bow really tight, straining to get it back, and throwing the hand.
Well, thank you. I mean, well, I had to work on that, but also, you know, this bow is what, like 51, 52 pounds. Yep. So, you know, that just speaks to if you have a technique that emphasizes keeping the periphery finessed, that, and you know, using most the central back muscles for most of your effort, then yeah, you know, it's going to look relaxed for most poundages.
So let's say someone is already an archer, but not a thumb shooter, which we have many of people in a group like this, or they're new to it. And let's say they can shoot the heavy bows with three fingers and they practicing the technique with the thumb now. What would you recommend when they asking to recommend the bow? What would you recommend poundage wise? How much, how less of the poundage they need to use to work on the technique? So let's say they're happy shooting every day 60 pound English longbow, and then of course they feel strong enough, would be recommended for you like a draw? Of course it's very individual, but would you recommend it?
Yeah, it's very individual, but I would recommend something lighter for sure. I mean, I would even start back with a introductory bow because the thing is, you know, the alignment of the forearm here versus the alignment of the forearm here causes a different sort of activation of the back and shoulder. And also the tendon here is going to need a little bit of conditioning as well. So I would say, you know, dial it down. If you were at 60, try it again at 30 or 40. And the thing is, the adaptation is not going to take too long either. But yeah, what do you want to say, Richard?
While you're talking about the wrist and the position there, can you talk a little bit about wrist position when you're drawing back?
That's a great point. Yes, thank you for bringing that back. So bring that up. So I like to think about a rope between the ring and the draw elbow as I'm drawing. So let's say that the arrow is positioned this way. Then what I'm looking for is that this joint is straightened out, the wrist is pulled straight, and you have a virtual rope going from the ring to your elbow.
That's quite why when I'm that pull it out idea. I like that. That's because everybody starts like this, and it's
everybody starts like this. Yeah.
Yeah,
I think you have
pull it out straight. Yeah.
Yeah, if you've got tension in the draw hand like this, or tension in the thumb knuckle like this, then that's an element that can get tired after a while. And you know, these are peripheral elements that if you have to have active effort in maintaining these, then it's you're going to get tired. Or if you use a bow that's a little heavier, then you know that's going to get strained and you can injure yourself that way. Like having this and pulling, like that's an easy way to kind of hurt this elbow right here. So I prefer keeping that knuckle relaxed, keeping that wrist relaxed. And it's like a rope connecting the elbow to the ring. And you're using that elbow to pull back. This keeps this part, keeping this part relaxed, simplifies the technique and it helps you feel a little more easygoing as you draw as well.
Yeah. So as we went through all the stages, what would you recommend for the archer itself to look at while shooting? Like, because he's got his shoulders down and then when he reaches the full draw, he's gonna go, I can't see the arrow. Most of people say I can't see the arrow tip because they used to shoot three fingers, and that panic kind of builds in, especially for archers who's been used to shooting Western style. That becomes a symbol of a, you know, maybe a little bit more with the elbow rotation as well, mediation elbow rotation and a bow arm. I think you haven't mentioned that too in the bow.
Oh yeah. What should I cover first? The what you see as an archer, or
yeah, I mean that's the sort of question comes around when people say, "Oh, I've tried thumb release, but I don't know how to work with this because I can't see the arrow."
Yeah, I think they tried the thumb release, and I think a lack of coaching is probably why people give up too soon for that. Now, as for what you see, yes, the arrow is on the other side, but you're gonna have to just look through the bow. You know, I like to open both eyes. And so what you'll see ideally is the target in sharp focus. And then the arrow in the bow will be fuzzy. It'll be sort of like—
Can I just quickly interrupt? So let's say someone turns up to your first session. Would you establish the dominant eye of the archer, or would you go with the stronger hand as a draw?
I would go with the— I've seen exceptions to both cases. Most people I know go with their eye dominance, but there are always exceptions, right? I think it doesn't hurt to try both left-handed and right-handed, but I would usually go with eye dominance. But
with your eye dominance, we will stick to drawing right hand for the right eye dominant.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't hurt to practice the other side, though. Like, for me, I think practicing left-handed, because I'm a right-handed shooter, but practicing left-handed illuminated aspects of my technique that I was kind of oblivious to. And I think that improved my right-handed shooting.
Thank you.
Right. Run through from scratch one more time for us, Justin. Okay.
Sure.
Can you describe it as you go, particularly with that shoulder? And
sure.
Then we're getting towards our half an hour.
Sounds good. So I'll just show the upper body. Let's assume that your stance is a 45 degree stance, that your hips, your lower back is straight, and you're going to raise your bow hand to about eye nose level. And you're going to keep the bow shoulder down below the bow hand during this. You know, and I have a full video on the bow shoulder itself, but just kind of press that bow shoulder down and towards your spine. That should help reinforce the position here. Maintain this angle. And then with the bow hand, you have the center of the bow handle in the middle of the crease of the web of your hand. The arrow is resting on your bow hand thumb. The thumb ring hooks around a string, touching the arrow nock. not too shallow, not too far around, but just right here. You cover the thumb with your index finger. You allow the index finger to lightly touch the side of the arrow here. Then from here, you make sure that the thumb, knuckle, the wrist are relaxed. You're creating a virtual rope between the ring and your draw elbow. Now you're gonna lead the draw with your draw elbow and draw until the draw elbow is closed. Draw until it's closed. My draw hand is right around where my ear is. Now I'm gonna continue to draw back, 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 release. And that's the basic shot in a nutshell.
Does look very, very smooth, Justin. Thank you very much. We're getting towards the end of our time, unfortunately. And I know we've got loads more questions for you. So, but thank you very much. I know Yassi appreciates it as much as the rest of the group and me. This was going to be just a two-part series, but maybe in a couple of months we can come back and get a little bit more detailed about some of the bits if we twist your arm a little bit, but not too hard so you can't shoot.
Yeah, no, I think it's
I know I'm imposing on our friendship, but I'm gonna do anyway.
Yeah, I'm happy to talk more about detail. I mean, I love talking shop, you know, talking about technique. This is kind of what I live for in terms of what I do with Chinese archery. I like to think about, you know, Chinese archery had a lot of different hardware, but there was also a heavy emphasis on software as well. And so, I mean, I'm a software guy. So, you know, I like to talk about the techniques and getting into the details of that. But I understand it's a long-term process as well, right? I'll show you this layer, this very basic layer of the shooting process that I introduced today. And then we can go into further layers about what happens with the shoulder, with the draw. You know, details about what are you doing with your core here and why it's not exactly one hand answer that fits all, right? Details about the thumb, the wrist, the draw, the release. There's so much to go into there.
Yeah, I really like what you said last time in the previous part, that 80% of this is in common and the rest 20% is very individual. That's what people can find their own ways of, you know, once they establish the right core.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, brilliant. Okay, well, I think we've come to a full half hour. It's been a great two episodes, and I think they're gonna really appreciate it, so thank you again. I'm sorry we couldn't have your partner here with us again for the second time, but maybe in the future. Anything to add?
No, I'd just like to thank you as well. Thank you very much. Your time is appreciated. We'd like to promote, you know, Chinese archery further. So no better way than having Justin showing us the basics of the forum. And I hope the members can take a lot from it.
Yeah, send us that feedback.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. Thanks for the opportunity.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And thank you. And I'm going to stop the recording. Cheers.
I mean,